Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 40 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast, and happy 4th of July to everybody. So this has been a busy few weeks. A lot has happened since my last solo cast. So no guests this week, just me. Every fifth episode, I'm going to give you my thought leadership and make you aware of some things that I think should be on your radar. And I've actually had a birthday since my last solo cast. June 15th, I turned 33, and I got the best birthday present from one Park Howe over at the Business of Story. If you guys haven't already, definitely want to check out that podcast. Go to businessofstory.com. Cannot recommend him highly enough. And Park had a brand story challenge on his Business of Story podcast, which I'm an avid listener to. So I entered the contest and I was actually selected to go on his Business of Story podcast and work through my brand story. He sent me his DIY brand story workbook, monster of a workbook, 64 pages, but it is thorough. And Park shows every bit of his 30 years of experience in branding and advertising. Really, really great exercise and getting your brand story straight. So thank you again to one Mr. Park Howe for sending me that DIY brand story workbook. And my clarified brand story is, you guys ready for it? Drum roll. Temi is the number one resource to teach you the reality of digital marketing to propel your career. Ain't that good, y'all? Like that is solid. And just the clarity and the confidence that he was able to instill in me after our 1 hour session on his podcast is precisely the feeling that I want to give other people when they're done consulting and talking to me, because your brand story is kind of fuzzy. Like you kind of have an idea what it is, but it can be very elusive and hard to put your hand on. And Park is really good about pulling that out of you and honing in on it in a way that makes sense, in a way that you can actually monetize. And so during this process, he asks your why, like, why are you doing this? Why do you do what you do? And it turns out that I'm actually a career and business counselor, because my why and one of the deep-seated reasons that I do this after you peel back all the layers is that I'm an activist who advocates for high professional standards in digital marketing. That's really why I do what I do once you get past everything, because one of my former guests, Jay Acunzo, has a pinned tweet on his Twitter that sums it up nicely, is that the downside of the information age is advice overload. I'm going to read that again. The downside of the information age is advice overload. And I'll be more frank, because let's just call a spade, there's a lot of false prophets and bad gurus out there, and they wreak a lot of havoc and give people a lot of bad habits that they don't even know that they have. This is a true story. Back when I was in Dayton, Ohio, before I relocated down to Atlanta, Georgia, I was involved in my local real estate investors association called GDREIA. And I know, sounds like a venereal disease, but it's not. It stands for the Greater Dayton Real Estate Investors Association. And so all of the REIAs, which is an acronym, REIA, which stands for Real Estate Investors Association, they all are pretty reciprocal with one another. So every now and then you'll have a speaker who will hit GD REIA and Cincinnati REIA and Columbus REIA, etc. So Vina Jones Cox, who is one of the premier wholesale teachers in the country, she's based out of Cincinnati, Ohio. She brought in a speaker out of Baltimore, Maryland, who's also a REIA leader out there, and a digital marketing expert. And he was talking about how he uses digital marketing to rent and sell his properties and had a lot of success. And he also takes on clients. So the speaker came into Cincinnati REIA and he made a stop at Dayton REIA. And how these things usually work is that whenever there's a speaker in town, he'll come speak to the, you know, general membership for free. And then typically that weekend or a week later, he'll have a closed door training session that's between, you know, $97 and like $150, depending on who it is. And so I like the guy, nice brother out of Baltimore. And so I paid the 97 bucks or whatever, and I went to his training, which was actually in Columbus, which is the Columbus REIA that Vena Joan Cox owns, and she helps run. She runs the Columbus REIA as well as the Cincinnati REIA. And so I get there, and this is, you know, there's probably 50 people in the room. And so he's going over all of the tactics and strategy that he uses to, you know, market his properties online. And I kid you not, this brother got up there in this room. This is a paid room, folks. Like, everybody in this room has paid $100. He tells these folks to keyword stuff. And I'm like, what did you just say? And I don't, you know, I don't make a scene or a big kerfuffle about it, but I do sort of, you know, gently ease in that, you know, keyword surfing isn't the best practice. And he's like, yeah, it's not, but it still works and I still do it. And so this was back in 2012 when I had first entered Full Sail University's degree program. And when I talked to this guy, who's a good guy, by the way, I'm not trying to paint him with a dirty brush. I very much so got the sense that while he knew what he was doing, quote unquote, he didn't fully appreciate the ramifications of some of the tactics that he was espousing and engaging in. It was very much so like some of these young ladies here in Atlanta. I live in Atlanta, Georgia now, which is the strip club capital of the U.S. Like, there's more gentlemen clubs per capita in Atlanta than anywhere else. And sometimes what happens is that these 19, 20 year old young women will come down for college and they'll get seduced by the fast money that stripping and on the extreme end doing porn in their dorm room can provide them. They know, quote unquote, what they're doing. Like, they're aware that they're dancing naked on the pole, they're aware that they're having sex on camera, but they don't fully appreciate the long-term ramifications that engaging in these things in their 20s is going to have on them when they're 40 and 50 years old. And that is very much the sense that I got from this guru out of Baltimore. He knew what he was doing, but he didn't really, really understand just what was at stake and what he was doing, because he also submitted a proposal to GD REIA to do some marketing for him. And at the time, I was a wholesale chairperson, so I got to go to the board meetings. I was not on the board. I was a chairperson, so I didn't get to vote. But I did have access to the meetings, and I did get to, you know, speak my piece, even though I was a non-voting member. And the proposal that this guy presented, he actually went through how he was going to get traffic and blah, blah, blah. And this dude had a link farm up in there. Like, I BS you not, I still have a copy of the proposal, which I will not publish because, you know, I don't want to get sued. I've been very careful about not mentioning the guy's name. But yeah, he submitted a proposal to our Real Estate Investors Association, and he had a link farm on there. And it's like, so you have these people who get a hold of these bad gurus, and it, quote unquote, starts working for them, because in their mind, money means that it's working, right? Well, I'm making money at it. That means it's working, because if it didn't work, I wouldn't be making money. And going back to the stripper and porn star example, like, there's a lot of unscrupulous things that you can do that aren't the best for your reputation that makes money. You can make a lot of money stripping, you can make a lot of money having sex on camera, but, you know, ask some of these older porn stars how that affected their lives in their 40s and 50s, and almost all of them will tell you that it wasn't worth it, that doing porn or stripping ended up costing them way more than whatever money that they made, because now they're completely estranged from their family members. They can't have a normal relationship or a normal sex life because, you know, of the activities that they engaged in. So marrying somebody is almost always off the table unless it's another porn star or someone who was also in that lifestyle. And so you're running a very big risk in engaging in black hat tactics, because especially if you're taking on clients, if you get a client and you do these link farm and all these keyword stuff and all these other things, and then your client gets a Google penalty and gets their site de-indexed, you're getting sued. Like if you consult for somebody and then you get their site taken down, they are going to look to you to recoup the money that they lost when their site was down. And you've had big companies like JCPenney's, Overstock.com, BNW.com. They've all received Google penalties messing around with black hats that they didn't know were black hats. They just thought, oh, they're gurus. They make money. It works. And then they messed around, got a penalty. And so the stakes are really high when you're talking about who you get your information from. And that's why I do what I do. And that's why I was compelled to start this podcast as well as write books and speak, because you have a lot of folks out here who are like, hey, I'm a guru. This works, this works, this works, just like stripping or hooking works. But they don't really know what they're doing is at that level, and that they're damaging or risking their professional relationship like they are, because in his mind, he was just learning the game from somebody who knew the game. He went to Warrior Forum or whoever and got a course and started doing what he was taught to do. And so even though he was engaging in black hat tactics, he didn't actually know he was a black hat, because like I've said several times, I did not learn the term black hat until I came to Full Sail University. Because newsflash, black hats don't call each other black hats. They call each other ninjas or gurus or mavens. They don't call each other black hats. That's a term. That's an industry term that someone else put on them for their non-scrupulous or unscrupulous tactics. But they don't actually call themselves or market themselves that way. And so you can find yourself on Warrior Forum in the clutches of these cheaters and not even know it. You know, take me, for example. I wrote a book back in 2016 called Beyond Buzzwords. We are dying for reviews. Like, we need reviews desperately. So if you're listening to my voice, please go buy my book. It's available on Amazon and thinkbehindbuzzwords.com. And please, please, please leave a review. That being said, there is a book by Daniel Lemon. He's on the Convince and Convert crew. Shout out to Jay Bear. He wrote a book, which Jay Bear did the foreword for, called Manipulated. And it chronicled how people basically game the system in terms of ratings and reviews. And if I were so inclined, I could go to Fiverr.com and pay somebody to review my book, send them the book. They do a video review, hold the book up, say it's amazing, and I could buy likes. I could do all of that on Fiverr. Now, how did I learn how to do that? Warrior Forum. Right. So if you don't have the level of knowledge that I have to know what's black hat and what's not, you might come across that same course or these same gurus, these same black hats, and just think that, OK, I'm learning the game from somebody who knows the game. It's not going to register to you that you're actually cheating, that you're actually engaging in things that aren't above board, and you're just going to go forth with that knowledge ignorant to what you're really doing, just like these 19-20-year-old women are oftentimes ignorant to the impact that stripping or doing porn in their college dorm is going to have on their lives when they're 40 and 50 year old women. And the thing about being a black hat is that there's no such thing about as being a little black hat, right? There's no such thing as being a little pregnant. You're either pregnant or you're not. And when you come to black hat tactics, you either cheat or you don't. And that is really something that I really want to, you know, advocate for in my mission to raise the professional standard of the professional digital marketer. Because, you know, and I'm sorry if that stung some folks, because I didn't come here to hit you, but I also wanted to make sure I didn't miss you. Because, you know, these black hats on Warrior Forum and teaching these unscrupulous tactics, they are not above criticism. And I'm not disrespecting my colleagues, but I am challenging them to do better, because we all need to do better. I know we all out here chasing money, but we got to have some principles, y'all. What happened to principles over profit, right? So going back to my man Jay Acunzo's Twitter on June 13th, 2017, Martin Lieberman tweeted that there's hardly any traffic when you take the high road. That's what this guy tweeted. There's hardly any traffic when you take the high road. And true to his nature, I love my man Jay Acunzo, one of my favorite guests. Gotta have him back on the show. He's really awesome. Jay tweeted in response, "The right thing is always the right thing. Make a great show and the marketing gets easier. Avoid the gimmicks. Do right by your audience. Period." And that's really what it is. But it's a little bit deeper than that, because before you can do right, you need to know what's right and what's wrong. And that ability to know that, you have to have something to compare and contrast it against. Because if warrior form is all that you know, if warrior form is all that you've been exposed to, and again, you're not aware that your guru is actually a black hat, then you don't have anything to contrast it against, and you don't actually know that you're engaging in black hat activities. So I'm going to take a short break for a commercial message, and then when we get back, we're going to dive deeper, so stick with me. We've all heard the stories. New mom starts a blog while on maternity leave, and now she's a multimillionaire. Or the pizza boy with just a GED who now makes more than all of his teachers combined. Or that one guy that got stricken with some calamity that left him bedridden for 6 months or something like that. You get my point. Insert cliche here. They would all have you believe it's as simple as getting online, finding success, and living happily ever after. Rinse and repeat. And eternal optimist that you are, you think, why not me? And you fall for it. Hook, line, and sinker. You quickly find yourself completely overwhelmed with digital business operations, disappointed, and ultimately disenchanted with the whole online success fairy tale. Well, friends, you're not alone. Now, I can hear the groans of objection now. You're just being negative. Those stories are real. That really happens to people. And yeah, that has been known to happen. And people have also been known to win the lottery or marry their high school sweetheart after falling in love at first sight. But then you have the rest of us. Those stories often leave out the lucky breaks, support systems, and hard skills needed to truly achieve success online. I don't. Through the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, I've connected you with top thought leaders and real online professionals, not outliers who don't recognize themselves as such. Through these candid, no BS conversations, we discuss what it's really like to achieve success online and give you the tools and strategies to do the same. Did you know I'm also available to you for speaking engagements, digital discernment workshops, and even one-on-one Skype or telephone consults? Go to consulttemi.com and book me for your next event. That's consulttemi.com and click on the speaking tab. You see, being a real digital marketing professional doesn't have to be a pipe dream left unfulfilled, but you gotta take the rose-colored glasses off and get real. So go to consulttemi.com to book me, and I look forward to seeing you in person. And remember, tactics change, but principles don't. So don't get bewitched by the shiny ball syndrome. See you soon. And we're back. So again, I was just recounting how Park Howell really helped me get to the root of my brand story and why it is that I do what I do. Thanks again to Park Howell. Everybody check out the Business of Story podcast. And I really think that the definition of success online needs to be broader than just making money, right? Because there's a lot of unscrupulous things that you can do to make money. You know, you can strip, you can be a porn star, you can sell drugs, you can run guns. There's a lot of things that quote unquote work if you're using making money as the success metric, but you know, they're not actually good things to do. And so the advice that thought leaders give needs to be contextualized to the situations that people are coming to them for. And one of the things that I really harp on, I'm big on, I've said before and I'll say again, is that digital marketing is not a monolith. Like a lot of people, when I first came to Full Sail University, I equivocated digital marketing to social media. And to do that, like if you said to me you did digital marketing, in my mind I would think, oh, my knee jerk would be you do social media. And it's so much broader than that. And what I used to say, I used to compare it to the medical field, and that is very broad and there's several areas of specialization. But I think a little bit better analogy is to say that digital marketing is social media is like saying that Walmart sells toys. Right. Well, Walmart does sell toys. Walmart actually sells a lot of toys. They are the number one toy retailer, especially around Christmas time. But they also sell groceries, jewelries, guns, games, gaming consoles, electronics, televisions, clothes. Like, there's a lot of things that Walmart sells above and beyond toys, even though they sell a whole lot of toys. And so it's the same with digital marketing. Yes, social media is a part of digital marketing, but just like Walmart sells more than toys, digital marketing is much, much bigger than just social media. And that's something that people really need to get a hold of. But because of the ubiquity of social media, especially Facebook, that's sort of their knee jerk, and that's what they can get a hold of them and wrap their heads around. And so I really think that, again, gurus and thought leaders need to put more thought into the advice that they give and how they educate people, because making money online is a very nuanced thing. Just like there's a lot of different things that you can do at Walmart. You don't have to do social media. You can get into email marketing, lead gen. There are several different ways that you can go about professionalizing yourself, and it really is going to come down to your circumstances, what you want to do, the space in the digital marketing ecosystem that you want to occupy, and most importantly, access to capital. Like, what sort of resources do you have to actually get into the kind of circles and the spaces that you want to occupy? One of the reasons that I got my degree in internet marketing was because of financial aid. I could actually afford to go, whereas a lot of these, regardless if it's, you know, ClickFunnels or Digital Marketer or whatever, a lot of your better conferences, and I tell you this on my show all the time, I'm not going to go through back through it here, is that a lot of time these conferences are cost prohibitive. And so while, yeah, you can learn the information oftentimes cheaper, you got to have that money up front. And so I recently also did an interview on Jay Bear's Social Pros podcast, which I'll link up in the show notes. And Jay Bear talks about how he just bought a boat and how his oldest child, his daughter, just graduated high school and is about to go off to college. Now, generally speaking, just, you know, without counting Jay's pockets, if you can afford a boat, you can afford to send your daughter to ClickFunnels Live and have her join Russell Brunson's Inner Circle coaching program, right? Like, if you got the money for that, then if your baby girl wanted to go to ClickFunnels, you could afford to do that. Now, that's assuming that she wants to be a funnel architect and she wants to service clients. She might have goals that are way broader than that. Say she's a fashionista and she's really into magazines, even if they're online, always has been. And she wants to be one of those opinion makers that shapes the fashion world and media. Then I would advise her that Condé Nast might be a company that she aspires toward if that's her end goal. Or maybe like her daddy, she wants to be in the B2B world and she's technologically inclined and she's really into AI and chatbots. And so maybe becoming a data scientist would be the right path for her. I don't know. I haven't spoken to her, but my point is that digital marketing is not a monolith. Like, there are several different areas of specialization and there are several different things that you can do. And the advice that you give someone is going to vary widely depending on their circumstances. Jay Bear's daughter, depending on what she wants to do, may not need to go to college. She might just need daddy to break out his checkbook or that, you know, that black card AMX and get her into Russell Brunson's VIP coaching or get a private consult with Jay Abraham or Michael Gerber or somebody like that, right? But again, it just depends on what she wants to do. So that's one of the reasons that I come down so hard on people who say don't go to college, like Gary V, because while I love Gary V, just due to his circumstances and his background, bottom line, a $10,000 paywall was never going to keep Gary V away from anything, whereas as little as a $2,000 paywall is more than enough to stop most people from my demographic in our tracks, right? Because, and again, that's not to take anything away from Gary V's hustle. He's Mr. Hustle, 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 hustles his face off. I got a lot of respect for the guy and his ability to play the long game, right? That disproportional land grab, get in early, get a disproportional land grab. I love Gary V. I mess with him. That being said, he inherited like a $49, $50 million wine business that he went on to grow on YouTube. And so if he wanted some type of vocational training, or he wanted access to somebody like a Jay Abraham or something like that, a $10,000 price tag was never going to keep him away. Like, that's not to say that he didn't have to sacrifice. That's not to say that it wasn't a lot of hard work, because it is, because entrepreneurship always is. But my point is, someone like Gary V or Jay Bear's daughter, their circumstances and their access to capital is vastly, vastly different than someone like myself, who's from the west side of Dayton and grew up in abject poverty, right? My first job when I was on my own, I was making $11.25 an hour, $22,500 a year, and the federal poverty line is $20,000 a year, or at least it was at the time. So I was $2,000 above the poverty line, right? And so paying $10,000 for a VIP training program was completely out of the question for me. You're literally talking about half of my yearly income. There's just no way I could have swung that. Whereas if you're like Gary V and you inherit a $50 million business, or you're like Jay's daughter and daddy can afford a boat, you have options that other people don't. And folks need to talk about this, and not enough people talk about this, because it's like, yeah, you can find the information, but make no mistake, at some point in time, you are going to run up against the paywall, and you need to know how to get around, over, through, or above that. And honestly, the easiest way to do that is just to pay for the information, especially when you're talking about the access to the thought leaders that you get. So take me, for example. I would not have had the level of success with my podcast and getting guests if it was not for Kerry O'Shea Gorgone. Kerry O'Shea Gorgone, if you guys watch The Big Bang Theory, Sheldon has his particular spot on the couch that he covets above all else. Well, in terms of podcasting, that spot on the couch for me, if I was Sheldon, is Kerry O'Shea Gorgone. Like, you can draw a straight line from, you know, Mark Schaefer, Rob Zaleski, Rob Z. You can draw a straight line from these people to Kerry O'Shea Gorgone, Jay Bear, everybody, basically. And they would not, and I would argue that they would not have given me the time of day or the deference that they would have if not for my proximity to Kerry. And if not for Full Sail, I would not have had that proximity to Kerry, because, you know, as you guys know, if you go back to episode 000, one of the reasons that I came to digital marketing in the first place was to get away from name discrimination in the workplace. But guess what? Name discrimination happens online too. I'm Nigerian, and it's common knowledge that a lot of Nigerians online cheat people, like they're crooks. There's 419 scams. They'll tell you that they're a prince and you inherited a bunch of money and blah, blah, blah. And so a lot of people are wary about Nigerians online, as well they should be. So if I was not connected to Kerry O'Shea Gorgone, and you just had this random Nigerian trying to get to know you online, you know, conventional wisdom says that you delete that friend request. And because of Kerry O'Shea Gorgone, I was able to get around that in a lot of instances and get into certain professional networks and professional circles that I would not otherwise. And again, the reason I chose Full Sail was due to the financial aid, the scholarship program, because you can say the same thing about, you know, digital marketer or ClickFunnels. Like, if you get into these circles, you have access to, you know, Neil Patel and a bunch of other folks, but you gotta have that money, right? You gotta have that cash. So all of that is, again, what was helped brought into focus by Park Howe on his Business of Story podcast. I'm not sure when that episode is going to air, but if it does air around the same time as I air this, I'll link that up in the show notes. Thanks again to Park Howe having me on his Business of Story podcast. And yeah, this is going to be a really good year, because I'm starting it off with that clarity that clarity of purpose, that clarity of vision, and knowing that, you know, I am an activist who advocates for high professional standards in digital marketing. And I'm really, really excited to have be armed with that as I continue on my journey. And so thank you guys so much for listening to the solo cast. I know I kind of got a little preachy coming down on my soapbox, but this really is something that I'm very passionate about. I put my heart and soul into, and I hope you guys can feel it. And so I will come to you next week with another great guest. And until then, keep it classy and stay awesome.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. Really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.